Ladies and gentlemen, citizens of the world, welcome to the second annual unofficial, official, non-Academy Awards podcast for the movies of 2014. And this time we have a very, very special guest. As you know, this is something that we do every year with our very good colleagues from Blokebusters. However, this year we have sent the Back to the Podcast Learjet to the United States, and we have exclusively flown over to the studio the wonderful Mr. Paul Hawkins. Welcome to the show, sir.
Well, thank you very much. Here we are.
You do know that you could have had more than one film on offer for the flight, right?
Well, we were tight, man.
Watching Lucy on a loop was not the best part of that.
How was the service, though? Did you get the little nuts with the little smoked almond things? Do you have those?
Yes, I got the two nuts that were in there, yeah.
Excellent. We didn't spare any expense.
You did
only
not.
The very best. Next year, of course, just means you'll have to fly us over to the United States to host it over there.
Let's do that.
We'll make sure we put it in the diary just before we'll sign off today, just so we don't forget.
Yes, don't want to forget that.
While you're here, is there anyone you'd like to give a shout-out to your endorsees or sponsors or your many fans back in the United States? Or would you like to explain why the hell Brian isn't here?
Well, I would be remiss to forget that we are now a part of the Pod Bros Network, and it's a great, great gang of podcasts that we put out our feelers for, and they were saying, hey, we like the idea of having a film podcast, and we happen to be the one that they took. I don't think they actually listened to us, they just had us on. But yeah, so it's been a lot of fun being part of that, and the reason that Brian is not here is he's in America.
He's actually in Hollywood, isn't he?
Yes.
He's had the phone call.
Yes, he's actually gone to talk with the Academy about what they did wrong.
Yeah. So we've dispatched Brian to handle that shenanigans over there for next year. And in the meantime, dear listeners, welcome to our Oscars podcast for the movies of 2014. And without any further mention, I think, Mr. Bear, let's have a look at some of the nominations for the first category.
We're going to go for the first category. So we've got a lot to look forward to in tonight's event. But for the first category, we're going to go to Best Male Actor. And the nominees for this are Benedict Cumberbatch for The Imitation Game, Bradley Cooper for American Sniper, Eddie Redmayne for The Theory of Everything, Ralph Fiennes for The Grand Budapest Hotel, and Miles Teller for his performance in Whiplash.
Okay.
Would you like to do the honours, or shall I? Or as we welcome them up here?
Yes. Shall we talk about why we sort of chose
these films?
Yeah, looked at some of these names for this.
I think for us it was a tricky one, this one, because I think we do endeavour to try and be different and steer clear of the Oscars general thing. But I think this year we felt that, well, I personally did that, actually the ones in the leading, you know, in the leading position were actually, you know, very, very strong on all levels. It wasn't, yeah, well, you know, it was too difficult to be controversial this year and go for something different.
Well, it is very difficult for the Academy to completely miss people when there actually are only these guys putting out fantastic performances, because I can't imagine them having put Dave Bautista on the list, even though he was fun. Like, I doubt he would have ended up on the list. This is, I think, probably the one category where it's most similar to the Oscars. And I think we know why Benedict Cumberbatch is on the list. I mean, he's fantastic.
He's generally an all-round good guy. I often find that this category is one we never have a problem finding lots of names for, and later when we do the Best Female Actress, that's one where in the past where we've been struggling. But the girls have done quite well this year, but we'll come to that later. I also noticed that with these movies, it's usually movies that have a heavy dramatic content in that seem to be the ones that seem to are very sort of strong in this category, where there's a lot of dialogue and considerable plot, and that's like if you look at the list there, you know, that seems to be sort of backed up by that.
Yeah, and most of these films had the actors given the biggest range, and that's what you need to base it on, really.
I think what we're looking for is that dynamic range of, like, the highs and the lows, you know, and that's kind of how we're going with it. So that's how we felt about it. I'm sure we'll get more into the films as the podcast goes, because these films often crop up in other categories. gentlemen, would you like to move forward with the nomination and, of course, the winner for this category?
So the winner of Best Male for 2014 is Eddie Redmayne for his portrayal of Stephen Hawking in The Theory of Everything.
Well done, Eddie. Well done. That is good work. Why did that one win over all the others in the end when we talked about it?
I mean, for me, as we already said, I think this is the only one where I have 100% agreed with the Oscars when I watched it live. He obviously won the Best Actor for the Oscars a few months ago. And I don't know, I mean, I think it was just, it was incredible to watch that as a performance. I mean, we all know, I mean, we did our podcast on it, I think you did as well, did you? And it probably all came up in conversation that, you know, the film was already very well made on a lot of levels, but then to watch this actor who was going through the motions of you know, portraying this, you know, disorder, and what a challenge that must have been for an actor's life to do that. It was just really incredible to see and do it so well. And I mean, it was something we brought up in our podcast where there was supposedly a scene at the end of the film where they used the real Stephen Hawking, and I didn't even clock it. I didn't even realise. You know, it just sort of a testament to how, you know, it was him. It just was him for the 2 hours of film, and I think he did it brilliantly.
I think so. I think my take on this one is that sometimes with actors, there's some amazing actors out there, people like Anthony Hopkins, but a lot of times you see actors, basically Morgan Freeman, do themselves a slightly different version of them.
Yeah.
But this is one where there's no way Eddie Redmayne could have stayed with him. He had to be a completely different person in every physical aspect to get into that for the whole thing. And it's like, that to me was like a hell of a lot of work.
Yeah, and as long as it came out with a lot of people really, really feeling the struggle, and I believe you guys mentioned in your podcast as well that Stephen Hawking said that at times he felt like he was watching himself.
Yeah.
So that's got to be the biggest reward that any actor can have, is someone saying that I felt like you were me. Like,
yeah.
That's what I was going for.
That, and of course the nomination and winning of this award as well from us. Yeah.
Not the Oscars, this one.
This is the icing on the cake.
Yeah. Yeah, so well done, Eddie.
Well done indeed, Eddie.
Right.
Should we move on to our next category?
Our next category is Best Female in a Leading Role. And the nominees are Jennifer Lawrence in The Hunger Games, Emma Stone, but I don't know what film it was from. I haven't written that down. It's the only hole in my paper. So we'll just pop pause there and we'll just work that out, and then I'll come back to you, listeners.
Can someone quickly look it up? I don't know.
Well, there's a certain embarrassing factor right now.
I hope it's not The Amazing Spider-Man 2.
I think
it wasn't.
Or The Amazing Spider-Man 1, maybe.
Okay, let's find it. And do you want to keep going with the list?
I'll carry on down the list. So then we've got Angelina Jolie for Maleficent, Zoe Saldana for Guardians of the Galaxy, and Rosamund Pike for her performance in Gone Girl. And I'm hoping Byron will just get me the name of that
film.
Could it have
been, she was also in Birdman as well.
Emma Stone in Birdman, was it Birdman?
And The Amazing Spider-Man 2. I didn't nominate her. So who put that name in?
Is that all she was in last year?
No, hang on, let me...
I was going to say.
I think there was another one.
If we can't find the film, we're going to need to officially...
Magic in the Moonlight.
That's the one!
Magic in the Moonlight. Well, there we go, right. Well, it sounds to me like me and Byron both have not seen this film.
Jesus.
Yeah. So you might be able to tell who didn't win.
Well, why don't you start with why you wanted Emma Stone in the list of best females?
All right. The short answer is, she was very good at Magic in the Moonlight, even if I couldn't remember the name of the bloody film. She plays in that film someone who is a psychic that the Colin Firth is sent to debunk, and the two end up getting fairly close together. And I just felt that every single beat in that film that she hit, she had to hit, like, being this psychic and then starting to get close to this guy but knowing that she shouldn't, and then a whole bunch of stuff happened. I don't really want to spoil it for anyone that hadn't seen it yet. And you really followed her throughout the entire film. But I will admit that, A, given that you two haven't seen the film, and B, some of the other people on this list, she's not going to win.
Oh, you spoiled the ending.
So, what about the rest of this list, then?
Back to that list, Bear.
Okay, let's read through the list again. So, okay. Jennifer Lawrence, Emma Stone, Angelina Jolie, Zoe Saldana, and Rosamund Pike. Byron, do you want to add in a few of your thoughts before we announce the winner?
I would like to say that one of the reasons I was plugging Zoe Saldana was because I felt that she had just great consistency in very strong feminine roles, which is one thing I personally really like, is this sort of quite distinctive... I always go back to the Sigourney Weaver kind of thing, you know, where she plays a very tough character in the Alien series. And it's like, I like that. I like that that women can have that role, especially in very masculine films. And I saw her in Guardians of the Galaxy, and of course we've seen her in Avatar. And I just like that she can step up and do that, and she could match strong male egos, especially fucking bodybuilders, you know.
Yeah.
So I like that she's got that sort of place in there as well, which is one of the reasons I like to nominate her. I didn't feel so strongly about Angelina Jolie, personally. And... what was the other name for?
And Rosamund Pike for Gone Girl, who I've just recently seen. I mean,
yeah, I saw that as well. Yeah,
recently finished watching Gone Girl, and I thought I was really impressed with the film. Anyway,
it's quite troubling, isn't it? Because it's the sort of thing you think could actually happen.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
In the twisted way that these sorts of things do happen. And
I mean, this film was a good one anyway because the story was great. It was really interesting and it kept you really interested. It was a long film, so a 2.5 hour film, 2 hours 40 minutes, whatever it was. And I thought she did brilliant. I mean, you know, Ben Affleck. He's in good films, but you know, whether he's a good actor or not is another argument, but he's always in very good and watchable films. But I think she was very, very good and watchable, and the thing about that film was that I hadn't read the book prior to the film, and I had no idea of where it was going to go. And I thought if you'd got the casting of that female lead wrong, the film could have taken a very difficult turn. And not in a good way. I mean in a sort of unwatchable, you know, difficult to portray. I think she was a very good choice for that role, but I don't want to say too much because I guess we're not spoiling these films in case people haven't
at least trying not to anyway. Spoil
people haven't seen them.
I'll not know what to expect. Well, I think we've reached that stage.
Okay, so the winner of Best Female for the movies of 2014 is Jennifer Lawrence for her role in The Hunger Games. It's like deja vu, isn't it, I think.
Yeah, now, for those of you that tuned in last year, as I'm sure is all of you...
And more,
yeah, is that we obviously had her as a winner for last year, and here she is again... this Jennifer Lawrence, and we thought, is it possible to have someone 2 years in a row? Paul, why do you think we would do that? Why do you think it happened that way?
Well, I would say probably two reasons. Number one is that I have yet to see her in anything where she doesn't do a really good job in the role. And number two, well, everyone else would probably say, like, just look at her, there you go, she's won. it's one of those things where I think she's going to become the next like Julie Andrews and like Maggie Smith. I think she's going to go through the rest of her career just knocking out solid hits, and she's going to be one of the ones to really follow.
The new Meryl Streep.
Yeah, there you go.
Do you think she'll also have as much powerful magnetism when she's, let's say, in her late 30s, so let's say 35 to 45, do you think she'll be the same position? Or do you think she'll go down the route of who's the lady that played Catwoman?
Halle Berry?
Yeah, do you think she's going to Halle Berry and tank it? I mean, what are your thoughts on this?
I'd like to think that she's got a strong enough head on her shoulders that she'll keep making smart decisions. I just... obviously, not being able to predict the future, I can't see what roles will become available to her as she gets older. But I think she's just going to become a staple, really. Kind of like George Clooney is. Like, he'll pop up in this and that and the other. I think she's going to turn into that.
I think what summed it up for me is when I saw her in Silver Linings Playbook and then American Hustle, where she wasn't playing particularly good-looking characters, which showed that, you know, she's not just getting hired now because of, you know, because she's obviously a very attractive woman, but it was nice to see her in two films where she was actually just hired for her acting ability, and they kind of roughed her up a bit. They made her look a bit like a sort of a, you know, a rougher looking character, and I think that sort of proves that she's actually a very good actress as well as, you know, a pretty girl.
Yeah, I think it's one of the things of kind of like the male version being Hugh Laurie, like, yeah, an attractive looking guy who can act really well, is incredibly funny, can play about five instruments. Like, it's just too much talent in this one person.
That's it.
Well, there you have it. So that's why she's appeared again, and who knows what could happen for 2015, but...
I think also it's just worth mentioning about Jennifer Lawrence, and this might sort of show the way she's planning on going, because I think she wants to grow as an actress, which has become apparent because recently she's gone out publicly and said, I'm not going to make any more of the X-Men films.
Yeah.
So she's currently filming the next one,
but she's
publicly said, I will not be making any more after that, which is very rare for actors and actresses to do in these big comic book chains, because there's always so many that go on, and it's very difficult to break away from. I think it shows that she's growing, you know, she's growing up, and she obviously doesn't want to be associated with this for that long.
That's the thing. I'm sure she's seen loads of people getting typecast in these roles, and that's just what she doesn't want. Because, I mean, obviously Hugh Jackman is now just Wolverine. There's not much else. Even in Chappie, he's Wolverine.
Yeah. Like,
there's not much to it there. So, yeah, she's definitely smart to get out and try not to be stuck in a role.
And I think that's an intelligent move from her. I think, you know, so good luck to her, we say. So let's see if she can make it a hat trick next year. Let's move on to our next category, which is the best use of visual effects. Now, so to clarify before we go through this, we're looking for the best use of, not the most or the, you know, the most explosions or the most green screen. We're looking for films that uses a nice variety of visual effects that really filter in nicely with the real action and the dialogue.
And not even necessarily the most polished, just like the ones where you know there's visual effects in there, but it's not front and centre.
Yeah. The best definition I heard a friend of mine say when he was trying to describe this to me a few years ago was the first Iron Man film was a really nice way of between, you know, real life and CGI, and you weren't quite sure where the CGI ended and where Robert Downey Jr. in the suit, begun. But then they sort of went over the top with it, and I think that's the sort of basis that we're looking at all these films, the best use of visual effects. So the nominations for this category are Edge of Tomorrow, Guardians of the Galaxy, Captain America 2, The Winter Soldier, Dawn of the Planet of the Apes, X-Men Days of Future Past, and Interstellar. So let's go into a few of why we pick these films.
I was particularly positive towards Interstellar because it just had such a clean look to the way they did it, and had such a you can't even see a little peep of light behind the curtain accidentally coming through. There was just no gap. There was all just so clean and smooth, and that was for me, you know, one of the ones I wanted to push in there. Paul,
no, yeah, I understand the feeling towards that. The problem I had when it comes to talking about the CGI in Interstellar.
Sorry about my chair.
That's right. The problem I have with the CGI in Interstellar is that it is basically front and centre for most of the scenes, and then you have them on what I can only imagine to be a little set, and then everything else is just filled in. It's just like such a heavy use of CG, and it's some of it did feel like, so, hey, look at this nice CG effect we've done. Like, so, rather than your simple simple small things that they either take away or add into shot, which you might just not quite be sure on. Mm-hmm. That being said, those robots are fantastic. I did enjoy Tars and the other guy that I can't remember the name of off the top of my head. What else did we have on that list?
So we had, we've gone through Interstellar, we had Edge of Tomorrow, Captain America 2, Dawn of the Planet of the Apes, X-Men Days of Future Past. I mean, I think Dawn of the Planet of the Apes sort of goes without saying, because anytime we see one of these films, they always try to do something new. We know the first one, Rise of the Planet of the Apes, had a very sort of revolutionary approach to the way it was going to perform these, you know, these actors in these suits. I don't know what the name of these suits are, but it's something Andy Serkis has done.
There'll be mocap there, probably.
Yeah,
that's what they normally are.
And I think, you know, with the sequel, you know, they had a bigger budget and they had more time to develop a more interesting plot line. And I actually really enjoyed the sequel. And I think it was sort of, you know, they basically just had more time to develop what they'd set up in the first one in terms of effects. And, you know, and for me, the second one really looked like one of the older Planet of the Apes films done in a sort of modern day. Like, I really like the sets and the... And where they were, it really looked like one of the sequels to the old Planet of the Apes films. Edge of Tomorrow. I mean, who's seen this most recently? Because yep. do you want to take us on Edge of Tomorrow, Brian?
Yeah, I just think it didn't really hold true for me in the way we categorised the best use of it. It was just the flagrant use of it to tie everything up together and. You know, huge amounts of battle scenes, and I think this is, for me, why, you know, I can't really, you know, say that it would be a strong enough contender to want to take the title.
No, I mean, the CGI was good, but there was never any point where they actually felt like they were really there. It was...
I think, yeah, that's one of the main issues, is the evil, sort of Martian-like creatures just felt a bit... hammy.
Yeah, I think if this was made in 2 years' time, they'd probably have access to technology that would give you just that extra polish on it that would have made it more seamless. But there wasn't enough smooth edges on them or something to just make it really feel like they were there. So, mm-hmm. And that's my argument, anyway.
Yeah, I think we agreed with that one. Yeah. So, without further ado, shall I announce the winner of the best use of visual effects category?
Let's have it.
We decided to go for Captain America 2: The Winter Soldier. This was a bit of a controversial one. We did spend a bit of time talking about this, I think. Mm-hmm. But for me, I think this really does epitomise the definition of this category. It's the best use of visual effects, and like I say, I mentioned, you know, the first Iron Man film. Obviously, we know that these films are in essence fantasy, science fiction. They're not real, but for me, it's like there's a difference between a film that is believable in the sense that you've got a nice balance between visual effects and the live action, as opposed to just ramming it full of CGI, which I don't believe they did with this. And I really felt there was some nice scenes. And I'd like to add that visual effects also doesn't just suggest CGI to me, it suggests car sequences and fight sequences, which there were a lot of fantastic ones in this film, especially the one with Samuel L. Jackson. It was the first time we got to see him sort of do a bit of proper action, you know, in a while.
Oh yeah, it's definitely one of those things where you've got your visual effects, which typically means like CGI special effect, but visual effects is really anything on screen where they're doing that sort of stuff. So yeah, I wasn't even thinking about the car chase scene, but that was a really well. And that's another thing of you got the CG of the dashboard and all that, so you're seeing all that, and then you got all the practical effects as the car's getting beaten up. So yeah, that was a good blend, thinking back on that.
Yeah, but I mean, for me, probably my favourite scene in that film, visual effects wise, was there was a couple of sequences where he took down a couple of the big ships, which are obviously heavily CGI, with his shield, and I just thought those sequences from a sort of choreographed point of view, and then the balance of CGI were just really perfect. I mean, and that film was great anyway. I mean, I think a lot of people agree that was a very good Marvel film that they pulled out, you know, after a few questionable ones. I think that was a very, very good one.
Well, I've always said that the Captain America films seem to me to be the ones where they take their time, they give you a lot of exposition for where they're heading with their franchises, while the other ones are the more exciting ones. So I kind of enjoy that every now and again they do take time to slow down and give you a Captain America 2.
Yeah.
While you're waiting for Guardians of the Galaxy or something like that.
Yeah, I think it's one of the things that we said was majorly important and was a very distinguishing factor between that and what's going to happen later this year with Superman and Batman
yeah.
and coming to the equation, and that was where it felt like they're really rushing that, and this has more of a pace to it, and it's more established and more grounded, and everything they do in the Marvel seems to work. It seems to even, and for me, and I don't like this genre, so for it to work for me, that's really saying something. Whereas there are other friends over there in tight suity land, you know. Wait, let's see what happens, really.
I think the thing that came to light with this film for me, a couple of my friends said that, you know, we're about to embark on the Star Wars journey again at the end of this year, and Disney are about to go down the Star Wars thing. And I remember a few years ago they mentioned the fact that they're going to do a similar sort of thing to what we've been seeing with Avengers. They're going to have, you know, the main three Star Wars, 7, 8 and 9, but then in between we're going to have these little sort of spin-off ones. And I remember, you know, I debated it with a few friends of mine. We were saying, you know, the spin-offs, who cares about them? You know, I'm not sure if I do. I'm not sure if they do. But then the moment we saw, you know, Captain America 2, and then we thought, hold on, you've really excited me with essentially a sort of a spin-off film here. You know, because really, we're just waiting to get to Avengers 2 or one of the bigger ones. And that's just one that, who would have cared about Captain America 2 before that film came out? And it came out and everyone was like, holy crap, I want to see Captain America 3 now. I don't even care about Avengers 2. And I think everyone started thinking, if they go the same sort of quality route as with the Star Wars is, and we start seeing, you know, spin-off Boba Fett films, and, you know, we get 1, 2, 3 in between Star Wars 7, 8 and 9, we could be in for a really interesting journey.
And I think that Marvel as well, they've got such a great business model going, like, Have either of you two been watching Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. or Agent Carter?
I haven't. I'd like to watch it, though.
But it's brilliant because, although there was one thing I will say, I was watching Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. every week as it was coming out, and I had to wait, I think, 2 weeks before I saw Captain America. They gave away the Hydra part of Captain America in the show because it ran in time with this episode came out the day after the film came out, so there was that. But I was sort of expecting something like that. So they've got all of these things running alongside, so you can watch these while you're waiting for this film, and then you're watching these films while you're actually waiting for the big films. Yeah. And so it's something that you haven't seen for a long time. I mean, the old studios used to do, like, big packages of these films are all going to be about this and we're going to do this, but, and then that went away and now it's kind of coming back, and I think a lot of other studios are going to be looking to Marvel for, we're just going to do this.
Yeah, exactly. They've planted a lot of seeds over the last, you know, 9 years or so, and I think we've got a lot more to come. Well, they'll keep doing it as long as people keep going, I guess, as long as people keep spending the money on it.
Yeah, it's the weirdest thing in the world. If you just said 10 years ago that Marvel, the comic company, is going to be one of the biggest film studios in the world. Yeah. Everyone's going to just look at you and be like, no.
So we were very, well, I personally was very pleased with Captain America 2, and I think to specify, I think best use of visual effects, I think definitely worthy winner. So moving on. To our next category, this is best minimal use of visual effects, or basically no visual effects. I don't think we ever specified which one, but we're basically looking at films that have very little or absolutely none. So we're just basing it on the text, the dialogue, the storyline, and everything else, as opposed to the effects. So the nominees are The Imitation Game, The Theory of Everything, Whiplash, and Chef. Byron, why don't you take us through some of the nominations for this category?
This is a game where we go back into dramatic territory, and you know you're going to get some real heavyweights in them, because whenever you've watched these films, you're going to really fight for them, because you just know, oh, there's some good stuff in there. And I think this is one where we had a bit of trouble sort of, you know, nailing it down going forward, because there's some really good stuff out there. One of the reasons I like this is kind of my favourite category is that I just think that we always talk about good, honest filmmaking. You know, what it all comes down to is like a bunch of talented people and some really good writing. And if you've got those two things, you don't need, you know, you don't need $100 million. You can do something with a lot less, and you can get amazing results just from making a really good film, you know, in the true essence of, you know, what is the importance of, like, the cinematic experience? You know, why did we all start off with it? Back in the origins of it, where did it come from? Where did acting come from? And for me, this is the category that takes you back to it. You know, there's no doubt about it. The Imitation Game is an incredible film because it charts real historical factual accounts. So does The theory of Everything. Now, Whiplash and Chef are two sort of more sort of dramatic interpretations and more sort of interesting stories. So we got kind of two versus two.
Yeah.
Interesting balance there. Interesting balance. Paul, you want to say a bit?
Well, yeah, I mean, when it came down to it, it's one of those things where the minimal visual effects does mean that it is entirely the story that is what you're going to be focusing on. And when it came down to it, there were, as you heard from the nomination, like, several films that really did heavily do just plot stuff. So it was kind of fun to talk about this beforehand while we were trying to settle it out in that what do we feel was the best overall film that has nothing to do with big spectacle. So
I have to say, one of the things I like about movies of this category, and one of the things I always say it's very important in a film, is that it should somehow move you emotionally in some way. Whatever that energy is, it should do that. Just as an example, I found The Theory of Everything was fantastic at doing that. Really, really good at doing that. Just totally push your buttons, you know. And I thought, that's really, you didn't need to blow anything up to do that, you know. You didn't, that I enjoyed immensely. You know, that's an amazing and a really important factor to me in this kind of category.
I think I felt very similar to you with The Imitation Game. I actually preferred The Imitation Game to The Theory of Everything on the whole. I think Eddie Redmayne's performance of Stephen Hawking stole it in The Theory of Everything, but as a general whole film, I preferred The Imitation Game. But for me, the thing that annoyed me, which is kind of ironic considering it's in this category, is they had certain very big random shots of big effect planes flying over London. For me, that you didn't need that, you know, like the film was strong and the story was strong, and we all knew the story you were telling. You didn't need to. I mean, we're talking probably in the whole film, we're probably talking no more than 12 to 15 seconds of this footage. There was just the odd shot every now and again of planes flying over. But I think, why did you need to put that in? And for me, I think that kind of basically shows you that hasn't won it. It's because we've sort of answered our own question. But
yeah,
I think for me, if they'd taken that 15 seconds or whatever out, in my eyes, the film would have been perfect.
Do you think
it would have been a proper contender.
Do you think in that example that they were worried about, perhaps the audience, their attention will drift if we don't do something like that?
Yeah, 100%.
Or B, we've just opened this briefcase and there's a whole other 80 grand we just missed. We need to spend it. We need to spunk this thing on something.
I think it's the former. I think that you can feel with the production value of The Imitation Game against The Theory of Everything that they were trying to target more of a kind of consumer's film, a blockbuster, if you like, as opposed to a Theory of Everything feels like a sort of more of a quieter film that not everyone went to see, but everyone I speak to have seen The Imitation Game over Theory of Everything, so perhaps they were going more for a bigger audience.
Well, I think as well that what might have happened is they filmed everything and then they realised we haven't actually set where this scene is or when this scene is. We need something to just put it here. How about this was the night when the planes went over? Okay, quick shot, done. I think it was possibly just slightly lazy screenwriting for that part. We'll set it up later.
Yeah, just whack it in, don't worry about it, lads. There's no problem. I mean, could it also be that when people talk about the imitation, somehow, you know, you get Chinese whispers, eventually you end up with something at the end, and you think, in this, they know they're making a film about the Second World War. And so Second World War, everyone thinks, oh, Second World War, Saving Private Ryan, we better have a few of these in. Yeah. So they think, we better chuck a bit in, hadn't we, boys? Because otherwise, all this Second World War bit, and we're not going to deliver the bit. What about a tank? Well, a nice picture of a tank. What about a nice picture of an aeroplane? You know, is it also kind of like, well, we better just in case?
Probably.
Yeah. Maybe a bit of all of those things.
Yeah. And the most annoying thing about not actually working at one of these studios is we're never going to know for sure what it is that did these. But it's fun to think about.
If you do, listeners, work at one of these studios and you do have the answer, you can go online to Facebook.
You don't mind exploiting your company.
Yeah.
And possibly being fired.
Yeah. Or text a private message to Facebook at Back to the Podcast or Blokebusters. We'll be listening very eagerly for that. Anyway, in the meantime, I think we should talk about where this led us, Bear.
Okay, so the winner for best minimal or no use of visual effects is Whiplash.
Nice.
So we came and ended up with Whiplash. I think this happened because a number of us had seen it and we were thinking it's really very true to the whole didn't need anything. Even in the theory of everything, I know that Eddie Redmayne had prosthetic pieces on the face and there's enhancement going on there. I know because I know someone that was in the movie and they saw it. So Whiplash, nothing. Okay, there's one little bit where there's a car accident, but even that is like, it's just incidental, you know. Incidental. Yeah. They didn't need anything for that.
Yeah, and the main reason there's a car crash is to slow him down and show his determination to continue on with this thing that he was doing.
Yeah,
so
the performance,
basically,
yeah.
It's just, I'll just put a little bit of blood on his hand and I'll just,
yeah,
they're done. So,
yeah, job done. Off he goes, and we're continuing with the story. So, that I think, I mean, Whiplash is. I've got this feeling that out here, people keep hearing us mention this during the podcast, and they're thinking, Whiplash, what the hell was that?
Yeah.
I've got this feeling they're out there, and I'll just say, maybe we should say a bit about the movie, just to fill them in on it. So, it's the story of a young guy who's attending music college, and he's a drummer, specialising in drums, and it's the story of his interaction as a young man trying to prove himself and to improve himself, and he encounters this kind of role model leader figure who runs the main jazz group. This is like the special forces of jazz, if you will. And of course he wants to get into this group, and inevitably he gets asked to go and sit in, and then the sitting in leads to him playing for it, and then it's this roller coaster between this character, this sort of young guy, versus the main actor who played by
J.K. Simmons,
who's just kind of the evil, like fucking Darth Vader without the mask, quite frankly.
I like to imagine that he is the twin brother of J. Jonah Jameson from the original Spider-Man trilogy.
You know, it's this great sort of headstrong, you know, role play between these two characters for the whole film, to the point where the guy who's, you know, Mike Taylor, who's learning drums and working on drums, is like practicing to the point where he bleeds, you know, regularly during the film. It's like, you know, that's some serious movie making going on there, you know, some serious stuff.
Well, I mean, the best way to describe his drive is something he says in the film. It's like, he doesn't want to be great, he wants to be one of the greats, and that's what you're feeling as you're watching it. So
yeah, you're feeling, you're watching the roller coaster and the escalation of all these things and the highs and lows that come with it. It's definitely a film that is very easily missed. I would heartily recommend it's checked out. It's a really good, solid film to watch, you know, with proper good writing, strong characters, really strong characters, and one of those ones that will get you, like, hating the bad guy and shouting at the TV.
And the only misstep I felt the film had, and I mentioned it in the Blockbusters, which that's one we did, is that the girlfriend character is kind of pointless. That's about it.
Yeah.
but even with that, like, solid film. Really good.
Yeah, there it is right there.
Well, that does actually bring us on to our next category, which is Best Young Actor, because the first nominee is Miles Teller for Whiplash.
No!
So, remember that one. Then we've also got MJ Anthony from Chef, Alex Lawther from The Imitation Game, and Byron, correct me if I'm pronouncing this wrong, but this is Tony Revolari from Grand Budapest Hotel.
I believe that's correct.
Which I haven't seen, but Byron was very adamant that he goes in.
I was. Okay, Grand Budapest Hotel. Oh, man. This was a movie and a half for me. This was a movie and a half. One of the main things about the Grand Budapest Hotel, if you haven't seen it, it's almost like a somewhat of a phenomenon in that all of the really big heavyweights of cinema seem to be in this movie. I mean, you've got just big name after big name after big name just coming up all the time, like Adrian Brody, Willem Dafoe, Jeff Goldblum, Harvey Keitel, Jude Law, Bill Murray, Edward Norton. It just freaking goes on and on and on. And you're like, oh my God. So you think, with all those really, really big names, why would you look at some young kid who you've never seen before? Why would you even bother with that when you've got such, like, it's almost like this director, the guys behind this movie, Wes Anderson, could literally ring up anybody he wants. Absolutely anybody, living or dead. Bogart, can you? No problem. I'm coming back.
I will reprise in the back of the scene.
I will reprise my role. It's like, God, is anyone not in this thing? So, one of the reasons I felt that was interesting because you have so many really, really big heavyweights. So why would you take notice of such a smaller character who's kind of surfaced out of nowhere? And that's why this guy comes out of nowhere. He's in the film like start to finish. He's a really key, integral part of the whole movie. And the whole story is just framed so beautifully. I mean, Anderson's done such a good job. This is just a great, great, great piece of cinema. This is why cinema should keep going, because it's just, it's well written. The images, the picture, the story, the setting, the timeline, everything is like, this should be in a screenplay, taken over to Hollywood, and when they do classes in screenwriting, it's like, guys, here is how it's actually done. This is the template. This is what you want to do. So this young guy, Tony, this character, Zero, it's like, he's a funny little character that sort of bounces around the whole time. Quite lovable, quite adorable. And he just has some great lines that come out. Most of the time he's very minimalist, but every now and then he comes out with a great couple of speeches. The one where he talks about where he comes from and the hard life he's had. It kind of comes out of nowhere, you know, and kind of like, oh, sets you back, kind of just puts you on your ass a little bit. So that was one of the reasons why I really pushed him, and hopefully we'll see him again, you know, in other movies.
Yeah, and basically everything you said is showing how good Grand Budapest Hotel was. When we actually came down to talking about who would be the winner for this one, I think I managed to get you to take a quick step back and just think, there's not too much of a range to this guy.
Yeah, now that was one of the things, yeah.
That was it. Like, you know, he's good and quite funny and like really comes off well on screen, but his character is relatively two-dimensional when it comes to a lot of things. So yeah. That was... after that 5 minute diatribe from turned out probably not going to win.
I think for us
it was really awkward
because we were sitting there going, does he know he hasn't won?
I do want people to watch the film though.
I perfectly agree it's a fantastic film. I love Wes Anderson.
I think the thing to mention is that we were both sort of torn between the other two, which were Miles. I mean, for Alex Lawther, I put Alex Lawther in as a bit of a wild card, who played the young Alan Turing in The Imitation Game, that I felt, you know, he did a fantastic job. He was a very powerful, you know, powerful little kid who did some very powerful scenes, but, you know, fundamentally wasn't really in the film that much, so can't really compete with some of the big boys in this list. But really, for us, it was a choice between sort of Miles Teller and MJ Anthony, from Chef, the boy in
the
Chef.
From Chef.
And right. I was really behind it because I felt that Chef was actually, you know, similar to how you described in Whiplash, I thought, really great little film, really nice journey, very different to Whiplash, no blood in it.
Kind of the alternative to Whiplash, but, really. It's very upbeat. For most of
but it was a very positive, you know, if ever you needed a film to show someone to get them out of their funk, you know, if you needed to prove to someone, look, it's not all about the money, it's not all about this job, if you want to go and do something then you should do it, this is the film to show that person, because it's a very sort of motivational, inspirational story. And I do believe that the child in it, MJ Anthony, who was the son of Jon Favreau, the main character, they really had a nice on-screen relationship going on, and the child really added a different dynamic. I feel if they'd written it with just the Jon Favreau character, it wouldn't have been anywhere near as engaging, because he had this sort of, you know, the very interesting relationship on screen to go off.
Yeah, my only gripe when it came to that is it's the thing that you see in Hollywood so often now, which is a kid who is way too mature for his age.
Yeah.
It's kind of interesting to see that. Obviously, the audience loves it when a kid who is 10 years old acts like he's 25.
Yeah,
like has the foresight that most adults don't in these.
Exactly.
But you then run into like, no one really does act like this, so he is as much playing a character as anything else. So, I mean, he was really good in it.
Yeah, he was.
I will give him that. It was very good.
Well, without further ado, to announce the winner of the Best Young Actor, it goes to Miles Teller for Whiplash. We presented such a good cases for all the other
actors. For everyone else.
But then it went to Miles Teller. And I think the reason is because you presented such a great case for the film. You know, it is such an amazing film. And I think the main reasoning behind this decision from all of us was the fact that you're really on that journey with that character. And you can't say that about any of the other contenders. You know, that film is about that character, Miles, you know, and Miles Teller delivered it so brilliantly.
I think even though everyone that watches it may not be a musical or a musician, I think that the scenarios that he faces with very sort of tough role models, everyone can sort of look back at a time in their life where they looked up to someone that was a tough role model that may not have liked but influenced them, or when they've been at home at the family table and like you think you've done something really good, then someone sort of puts you down, and that the way the character handles that conflict, and you know, there's these things that kind of go, oh yeah, that's kind of happened to me. And there's some great moments that give that actor the opportunity to give you a response in those where you can go think back to your own life, you know, either a reflection or, oh, he did it differently to how I did it. But either way, when it's done in the story, it's a great moment, I find, when I watched it.
No, I was going to say, you actually touched on it. My favourite bit in that film is when he is at the table with his dad and the two other guys who I'm not 100% sure exactly what they were doing, but they're clearly like quarterbacks.
Was a sport, yeah,
at a sporting university type thing, and he's trying to put across like, what I'm doing is incredibly difficult, and everyone's just like, yeah, okay, well, how about this guy, he was throwing this touchdown earlier. Like, and just seeing that scene, it was fantastically done, sir.
Yeah, it was really well put together, and it's just it's a great moment in that movie. Such a juicy moment quite early on, and you're like, you know what's going on. They kind of don't, and it just gets you inside that story, doesn't it?
Yeah, and it's also one of those things that if you're watching the film and not that into it, you could come away thinking that he actually hasn't come out that good from that conversation. But if you are with him and actually following it, it's like, you know, that's the best result he could have asked for out of that. So
Well done, Miles Teller.
Great. Well, moving on to our penultimate category, the bit of the joke card, which is the worst film of 2014.
Right, let's have them, Ben.
Sin City 2, Dumb and Dumber 2, A Million Ways to Die in the West, and Big Hero 6. Now, I can't comment too much because 2 out of the 4 I haven't seen, Sin City 2 or Dumb and Dumber 2. I haven't heard great things about either of those films. A Million Ways to Die in the West I have seen, and frankly, I enjoyed, but I can see why a lot of people always mention that wasn't a great film of that year, and I can see why. Big Hero 6... I was Byron.
Right, okay, so let's just explain the Big Hero, because I'm sure that there's a good deal of young people that quite enjoy Big Hero 6 and probably really like that one, and probably a few parental figures that's the kind of film they take off the shelf, buy it, get it home to the family, because they know it's going to be a winner. So why would we try and pan it in this fashion? Well, you've probably heard us talk about it in podcasts previously, but I just felt that for the team that was behind it and from what they were capable of and what they were trying to do, it didn't feel like they were really very committed or really thought out with the movie. I just felt like it was just overall very weak. They hadn't really locked down a good portrayal of a character. And I know I'm being hard, I know it's supposed to be, it's a young person's film, but so what? I don't care. You know what? So the Hunger Games, you could argue that's a young person's. Harry Potter, if you watch the last two or three of those, you could argue that's a young person's film. But I tell you what, when I watched those movies, those young person's film, they absolutely held up with really, really good cinema of any genre. They stood their own. So it's no excuse. So for me, that's why I felt, I don't feel Big Hero 6 is a kind of contender, you know, that's you know, made the way it could have done, and it's in the worst film bracket for me.
Well, shall we announce the winner, and then you can tell us why that particular film
reel it out.
Which is, so the winner of the worst film of 2014 was Dumb and Dumber 2.
I lasted about 20 minutes in this movie. I got about 20, maybe, let's say 25 tops, and I could not go any further. You know that TV series, Man vs. Food, where he gets something so hot that it nearly blinds him? This is what it was like in cinema for me as a critic. It was like, I couldn't go any further, and I just couldn't take it anymore.
It's that age-old problem, isn't it? Of sequels to comedies, isn't it? That's the problem, because, I mean, I haven't actually seen Dumb and Dumber, because I knew from the trailer that I will not enjoy this film. But I know how you feel, because I felt the same with Anchorman 2, when I watched it, and just thinking, it's like you've sat in a boardroom and gone, right, what worked with the first one? Great, let's do more of that.
And the real sin of it is, I'm telling you now, I reckon those two guys, Kerry and
Jeff Daniels,
were really, really thinking it was a good idea. I bet they were like, "Oh, this is going to be so good. This is going to be so funny. It'll be just like when we were back in the 90s." No, boys, no, it won't.
It is a shame, isn't it? Because those two are such good. They are so good in their own right. Yes. And really, the film, they've done a full circle, because one would argue that Dumb and Dumber really was one of the films that sort of made Jim Carrey's career. And
I'll tell you, it made Jeff Daniels.
It made him for what we saw him as in that film. I think he was taken quite seriously before, and now they've gone sort of full circle where they're obviously a bit bored and a bit, you know, running out of a bit of cash and,
something to do, but, hey?
Brian, me and Brian actually kind of ragged into this on our podcast, the biggest issue with it was I think the amount of time that passed between the first one coming out and this one was the problem, because they kind of like how Wayne's World 2 is fairly similar to Wayne's World 1, but they then take their own spin on it, and because they came out 2 years apart, like everyone was still into it, whereas this one, everyone has seen the first one 30 times. And then you go and see the second one, which is exactly the same as the first one, but in a different setting. Like, there's almost nothing in it that they didn't do a version of in the first one, with the exception of, I think, the daughter subplot. And, it was dull, which is the worst thing you can say about a comedy. It was just dull.
Yeah.
I just don't think comedies... sequels to comedies like that normally don't ever work.
Yeah, the problem is...
This isn't a good advert for it.
It has to be done perfectly, or it'll fail.
Yeah, Well, moving on from that experience. So we come to our last category of our 2014 film, which is the best film experience of 2014. You remember we did this last year. Again, to summarise, it's the one we walk away from having the most fun. It's not necessarily the best film, it's what we enjoyed watching the most, the one where we walked away with the biggest smile and having the most fun. So the nominations are Whiplash, The Theory of Everything, Guardians of the Galaxy, and The Grand Budapest Hotel. Before I announced the winner, I was dead set on this. I knew the winner of this before I even wrote any of the other nominations down. And so there was only one answer to this for me. I don't know how you guys felt, but...
I had a foot either side on this one. For me, this is a category that has to have a feel-good factor about it. But it's also, for me, what's really important about this category is that this is why we go to the cinema. This is why it's worth taking $20 or whatever and getting that ticket.
Yeah.
That's an important thing of this category. So for me, I felt very strongly about a couple of movies in this list. Paul.
Well, the problem when it comes to, like, you have the Oscars, obviously, is just best film. and that's just critically what people think is the best film. Whereas what cinema is, people can argue that cinema is an escape, just trying to leave behind reality for a while, just get into another universe and soak it in. And if you come out of a cinema bawling your eyes out, they've succeeded. It's actually been a great experience for you because you've been sucked in. If you come out laughing your ass off, again, they've succeeded because you've gone into a comedy and it's been fantastic and it made you laugh. And you go into an action thriller and you are on the edge of your seat. That is why people want to see cinema, and that's what we're looking for. You don't just want, well, that shot was fantastically done. Yeah. You want that film was fantastically done.
Yeah. And I think when you come out of the cinema, it leaves you thinking about the film for hours and days afterwards. It's on your mind. It really has got you, and you want to talk to people about it. And this is probably of all the categories, is the one category where you absolutely need to get this film in your collection if you don't have it. If you're only going to buy one DVD, this is the one you're going to get, right? This is it. So get ready.
So without further ado, let's announce the winner of the best film experience of 2014, which is Guardians of the Galaxy.
Yes.
We were all, I think, 100% behind that. Yeah, we were all totally happy with that one. There was very little bickering, and the knives were put away, and it was all very amicable.
I think the surprise for me for this one was that I think it was one that I just didn't see coming. I mean, you're not a follower of
really
Marvel.
I'm really not.
But I am, and
he's
I follow the Avengers and the Captain Americas, and this is the one that I didn't really know much about, before it. They didn't really overplay the trailer. I didn't really see much of it. I thought this looks a bit weird, but it just looked a little bit sort of, oh, they're just going to chuck this out for good measure. And I went to see it and loved it, and I have to say I went to see it three times at the cinema. It's the only film for a while that I've done that to, and then I bought it on Blu-ray the day it came out and watched it a fourth time and just love it. And I walked out saying, and you misunderstood me here, because I walked out saying that's what I want Star Wars to be like, and I don't mean in terms of plot or it's just
worried me for a minute then.
What I meant by it is the fact that I sat there as a 28-year-old man in the cinema watching Guardians of the Galaxy, and it took me back to feeling like a kid watching Star Wars for the first time, like being genuinely excited and enjoying the action and getting involved with the character subplots and stuff like that. And that's what I meant by it. That's what I want Star Wars to be, because I want it to grab me and go, this is awesome.
I can agree on that.
Yeah, well, for me, it was it wasn't identical, but it was damn close. Like, coming out the year before, having seen Pacific Rim, and I just felt like a kid again. I actually just got chills again mentioning Pacific Rim. It was one of those things that you just come out, I wasn't thinking at all during that film. Yeah. I'm watching this thing wash over me. It was so much fun. And they had so many of the right people playing those roles as well. It was, as we said earlier, Marvel knows what they're doing. Yeah. And I think we should just let Marvel have a hand in every film now. Just have one person from Marvel go to each studio and just give it
quality
once
control.
Over. Yes, exactly.
Well, someone, it might be more Disney than Marvel. We don't know. They're the ones writing the checks, but maybe Marvel are the ones that are making the creative decisions.
I'm fairly certain that Marvel's making the decisions. I think Disney bought them and just went, just keep doing it.
Do what you want. We'll write the checks out for you. I think the thing with Guardians for me that really surprised me is people are often afraid to make films in, I know they're not new characters, but I think they're new characters to sort of comic book lovers, because they're not well known characters. They're not like the Wolverines and the Spider-Mans and things like that. And I think often filmmakers are afraid to make new films, which is why we're seeing so many remakes at the moment and reboots and things.
Yep.
And I think this film proves that you can go in with a film that's relatively unknown and take characters that are relatively unknown, but by the end you're rooting for them, or you're grooting for them.
Lovely.
Nicely done.
but it's true, because at the end of that 2 hours, you're feeling something for these characters, where it, for me at the beginning, I had no idea who any of them were, and that proves to the nervy filmmakers that you can do it. You can win over an audience in the space of one film without having to reboot an existing story just so you've got an existing fan base, and that was the thing that rung true for me with Guardians.
Well, and that's the thing as well. Like, could you imagine? Obviously, you've got the Avengers, where you've got your Iron Man, your Captain America. They've all been established, and then they get their group film.
Yeah,
I couldn't imagine them trying that with this group.
No,
because obviously everything you needed to know was the film, and they ended up as the official group by the end.
Yeah,
and that was the smart way to go. Yeah. So it's something where you get to see. Well, we know that you can have standalones and then a group film, but you can also have a group film.
Yeah.
So you left them to their own devices and they were able to work it out. So, yeah. I don't really have anything bad to say about this film.
And I'm really looking forward to seeing more.
Yeah, that's, two years, I think.
It's worth the wait, gentlemen.
Yeah, exactly.
It's worth the wait. Okay, well, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for tuning in to this very, very special second annual unofficial non-Academy Awards podcast for the movies of 2014. As usual, if you've enjoyed listening and tuning into this, you can leave a comment on iTunes, which always helps things out. You can also find us electronically on the World Wide Web on Facebook for our services. This is Back to the Podcast, and I believe it's Blokebusters.
Indeed.
The very fine gentlemen in the United States that keep you informed and updated.
Although, I will say, for us, Twitter is our best. One, that's at Blokebusters, because it is so much easier for us to keep in contact with people getting a hold of us. So, yeah, do check us out on there. And I also do a little thing with another podcast called Soiled Restroom Cinema. Lovely name.
What kind of movies is that reviewing?
Oh, well, that's the thing. They take some of the worst films you have ever seen and rip into them. And so what I've been doing is watching the film ahead of their podcast release and then ripping into it myself the night before. So you can kind of follow me doing that and then listen to theirs the next day. So it's been a lot of fun. It really has. So you can watch out for me doing that, as well as us in general, just on Twitter at Blokebusters. So
fantastic. Well, it's been fun. It's been an enjoyable experience, and that concludes our review of the our Oscar celebration for the movies of 2014. If you like Pina Colada. That sounds kind of mean, but me and my